Thank you. Where does magic come from? Look around. You'll find it everywhere. It's there when you're sleeping and in your first waking moment. There on your way to work, nurturing new experiences with family and friends. But magic doesn't just happen. Magic is made. Throughout history, it's been born of sweat and toil, calluses and frustration, a deep curiosity, the need to push ourselves, and then push a little harder, until finally, a new revelation begins to reveal itself, or an unexpected eureka appears in an instant. And once it arrives, perseverance takes hold. You rethink, rework, and refine. Try, fail, start again. Only then, after effort is turned inspiration into innovation, are you ready, really ready, to change our lives. Because that's when the magic happens. And it's not hard to recognize. It's there in the glow. It's in a stride. In our ears. In our grasp. Magic. Wherever it comes from, you've conjured it. And once again, magic has made its way here. Are you ready?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President and CEO of the Consumer Technology Association, Gary Shapiro.
Welcome to CES 2019. I so much hope you're enjoying the show so far. You know, we had some outstanding keynote presentations during opening day yesterday. IBM Chairman, President, and CEO Ginni Rometty discussed new technologies such as AI and quantum. And Verizon CEO Hans Vestberg gave us a deep dive into the potential of 5G. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing another extraordinary technology industry leader to the CES stage, Dr. Lisa Su, President and Chief Executive Officer of AMD. AMD, yes. AMD is a high-performance computing force behind much of the technology you use every day. Whether it's a personal computer, a game console, or some of the world's most powerful servers. This year marks AMD's 50th anniversary, delivering high-performance computers and graphics technologies. During that time, they have consistently pushed the envelope when it comes to creating some of the industry's first, best, and fastest processors. In 2014, Dr. Lisa Su took the helm of AMD and led the company to several significant achievements. Over the past 24 months alone, AMD has introduced more than 10 different product families across more than 50 new product launches, targeting the high-performance PC data center and high-end graphics markets. Some notable products: AMD Ryzen Threadripper, the industry's first 32-core high-end consumer desktop processor. AMD Ryzen Mobile APU, the world's fastest processor for ultra-thin notebooks. And I'm trying to move this along. AMD EPYC, the high-performance CPU that is redefining the competitive landscape across the traditional IT, cloud, and supercomputing markets. Now, in 2019, AMD is poised to launch the world's first 7-nanometer CPUs and GPUs, providing the power required to change the industry. All of this hard work and these achievements have led to Dr. Su being named one of Fortune magazine's world's greatest leaders in 2017, as well as 2018 Business Person of the Year. Today, Dr. Su joins CES to talk to us about the capability of high-performance technology to solve some of our world's toughest challenges, when placed in the hands of today's researchers, creators, and inventors. We can't wait to hear, so let's get started. Please welcome Dr. Lisa Su from AMD.
For that great introduction. And boy, does this look like a great crowd here in Vegas. Thank you all for joining us here today. And to all of you who are watching the CES live stream on the live stream. This is a really significant moment for AMD, and it's a significant moment for me. It's actually the very first time that we are giving a keynote here at CES. And I'm really excited to have the opportunity to explore the future of computing and graphics technologies with you this morning. I am honored to lead one of the world's most innovative companies. At AMD, we are focused on providing high-performance computing solutions, powering some of the most interesting and most important applications in the world today. Now, Gary mentioned this year is AMD's 50th anniversary. AMD was founded actually as a Silicon Valley startup. We started with just dozens of employees, and we were focused on leading-edge semiconductor products for a broad set of markets. But from those humble beginnings, we have now grown into a global company of almost 10,000 people. And we actually stand every day for pushing the envelope in high-performance computing. Just think about a few of the highlights from our history. In 2000, we launched the world's first gigahertz CPU. In 2003, we led the industry transition to the first 64-bit x86 processors. And by the way, these are still the de facto standard for PCs and servers. In 2008, we launched the first single GPU to deliver a teraflop of compute performance. And in 2011, we were the first company to combine x86 CPUs and high-performance GPUs onto a single chip that we call an APU. And over the last 7 years, we have powered the highest performance game consoles that have ever been produced, from Microsoft's Xbox One family to Sony's PlayStation 4 families. So for all of these, they were industry firsts, and all of these were delivered by AMD. Now that you know just a little bit more about us, let me focus on some of the trends that are shaping the next few years. I feel actually incredibly lucky. It's an incredible time to be in the semiconductor industry. You know, if you think about it, we're actually at a point where the growth in the number of connected devices has transformed virtually every single industry. And if you take a look at some of the market research, there were 15 billion connected devices in 2016, and that number is expected to double by the time we get to 2025. So over 34 billion connected devices. And even more importantly, I think what's really important is the volume of data, just the amount of data that we're creating with all of those devices. We're expected to grow that by over 10x over that same time period. That's 175 zettabytes. 175 trillion gigabytes of new data in just 2025 alone. Now, why is that important? Well, you really need high-performance computing so that you can really visualize and analyze and, most importantly, make decisions based on all of this data. So when we look as an industry, you know, what really excites us is how do we deliver all of that computing performance? How do we keep on that trend line so that we can accomplish all of this with high-performance computing? And what I would say is to do that, it's going to require new approaches and new innovation. And frankly, it's a phenomenal opportunity for all of us to create new leaders. So, you know, when you take a look at what's governed our industry, you know, we keep talking about Moore's Law. You know, Moore's Law is something that has been around for a long time, and it's really governed the pace of innovation in the semiconductor industry. So, performance doubled every 2 years, and we got more transistors per unit area, and that was really good. But frankly, life got a little bit more difficult. So, over the last 10 years, that trend has gotten a lot slower. And what that means is that the time between the introduction of new manufacturing technologies has actually increased as scaling has become much, much more difficult. So, from an industry standpoint, it places a really significant premium on innovation. Innovation around design, innovation around architecture, and all of that is necessary so that we can keep powering all of these new devices. And so, at AMD, this is what gets us up every morning. This is what we focus on. We focus our innovation on how to get that trend line above and beyond where we currently are. And there are two main thrusts that we believe in. The first one is heterogeneous computing. And what that is, you know, we have so many applications in today's world, whether you're talking about the cloud or you're talking about at the edge, and you need to use the right computing for the right application to achieve the best possible performance. And delivering that requires CPUs, it requires GPUs, it requires some accelerators from time to time. And the important thing is how do you put those things together in a heterogeneous solution? Now, at AMD, we pride ourselves in putting together solutions, putting together CPUs, GPUs, optimized in a system environment. And during this next hour, I'm going to show you some of that technology in action. The second important thing, and this is what a lot of us in the industry are focusing on, it's pushing the bleeding edge. Pushing the bleeding edge of high-performance computing. And what I like to say, you know, what's so exciting about tech is, you know, we have to decide beforehand. We make decisions today that will affect us 3, 4, maybe even 5 years later. And you don't know if they're going to work, frankly. So, a couple of years ago, we saw some fundamental bottlenecks to increasing computing performance. And we made some big bets. We made some big bets about where we thought the industry was going to go. And 2019 is a key year where we see some of those big bets really pay off. So today I'm going to show you some of the things that will get us a significant inflection point in performance. And when you look at those pieces, it's new CPU and GPU cores. A lot of excitement around Zen, Zen 2, Radeon. We're going to show you the aggressive use of 7-nanometer manufacturing technology. And we're also going to show you how new system partitioning really can make a difference, thinking about the system a different way. I'm also really happy to say that we'll be joined on stage today by a number of our really good partners to really show you how that performance really happens in action and what's possible across a number of important end markets, things like content creation, gaming, cloud computing, and even supercomputing. So, with that as an introduction, let me get started and talk first about high-performance PCs. You know, the PC market is actually a really interesting market. If you take a look at it, the installed base of PCs worldwide is about 1.5 billion. Every year at CES, every OEM comes and shows their latest and greatest thing. And the PC market continues to be one of the most important markets for a couple of reasons. First of all, consumers like the productivity of the platform. It's a great platform. Enthusiasts love to push the envelope. They love gaming, they love VR. And then when you look at content creation is actually primarily done on the PC. So you look at us today, this is a beautiful theater, and it's surrounded by megapixels of displays with millions and millions of colors. In this environment, I think about how high-performance computing actually has transformed visual storytelling. You know, creators are amongst the most demanding, and they're most vocal, but also the most passionate AMD users, because they really benefit from every ounce of performance. And so whether you're talking about the latest MacBook Pros or iMac Pros, which are exclusively using AMD discrete graphics, or you're talking about high-performance workstations, all of these desktops are the tool of choice for the most demanding creative workloads like 3D modeling, rendering, game development, and virtual production. So let me just tell you a little bit about the tech in this market. In 2017, the best processor for creators had 10 cores and cost over $1,700. We knew that we could do better. We knew it. And so we created Threadripper. I can see Threadripper has just a few fans in the audience. Look, Threadripper is the number one selling high-end desktop processor. And why is that? Because for that same $1,700, you now get 32 cores and 64 threads and leadership I/O and leadership memory bandwidth. And that's nearly 3x more performance and 3x more capability delivered to the creators in just a few years. And if you just look at that from a performance per dollar standpoint, there you have it. There you see the step function increase when you really put your mind to innovation. And so for this group of users who need every last bit of performance, Threadripper is a game changer. So let's hear a little bit about how Threadripper is actually used in the world of virtual production.
Fox VFX Lab is now the virtual production front end to all Fox projects. Virtual production, it's kind of two words Jim Cameron and I kind of put together. We couldn't fly a film crew to Pandora, so we had to come up with a way to do this, and by sort of mishmashing all of these various technologies together, we were able to, you know, film the movie in a motion capture space similar to what you're seeing here. Our storytellers get to live in a completely virtualized environment, put on a VR headset, look around, see the world at scale, see their actors playing the parts of those characters in real time.
Virtual production couldn't really exist before you could do motion capture practically on set, and that required a lot of compute horsepower. There was no question about that.
What's the best possible piece of hardware that we can use to help our storytellers work as quickly as they can? Time is our most valuable asset.
A director or a producer walking by, they're not going to sit around and wait for something to render. They want to see it now.
When the Threadripper showed up, that was like the coolest band these guys had ever heard came to town and played a show for them.
Light baking for us is a big deal.
With the Threadripper machines, with all the cores in them, you know, I mean, that gets done a heck of a lot faster. The Threadripper has kind of like created this kind of shadow empire of rendering capability.
With the Threadrippers, we were seeing a 20-30% increase just right out of the gate per artist.
Having AMD facilitate that acceleration is instrumental to what we're doing here.
AMD has really shown that they're very interested in this space. They really want to help content creators.
It's nice to have a partner in the industry that looks you in the eye.
This is unique. I've worked on other shows with other large distributors, and yeah, you get your hardware, but they're not necessarily listening to what exactly you're looking for, and AMD has been doing that.
It's really, really great to see how the creators at Fox VFX have really taken advantage of Threadripper and everything that it offers to redefine the creative process. And we're going to talk more about desktops for AMD later on. But now let's go to the other end of the PC spectrum, the ultra-thin notebook. 160 million notebooks will be sold this year. Users around the world are actually choosing the ultra-thin form factor, and it's the fastest-growing PC category. And our vision for ultra-thins is actually pretty simple. We want to bring desktop-level performance to a thin and light notebook with all-day battery life. And we really showed this at last year's CES with the introduction of the AMD Ryzen mobile processor with Radeon Vega graphics in the first generation. At the time when we launched it, it was the world's fastest processor for ultra-thins. Now, this week at CES, earlier this week, we actually introduced our second generation Ryzen mobile processor. And thanks to using 12 nanometer manufacturing, our Zen Plus core, and a lot of new features like longer battery life and better performance than any mobile processor that we've ever shipped, Ryzen second generation is still the fastest processor for ultra-thin notebooks. And when you take a look at some of these numbers, when you're running everyday tasks like loading web pages, up to 14% faster. Editing media, up to 27% faster. And more than that, there are many, many new features. When you look at Windows Modern PC Initiative, for example, very, very cool stuff. Voice Wake, you can check the weather or look up a recipe. Modern Standby, your PC is always connected and up to date like your smartphone. And of course, streaming 4K HDR, so you can watch your favorite movies and your favorite shows in the highest quality. And one of the most important things is battery life. We want to be able to use this all day. And so in second gen, we offer up to 12 hours of general productivity and 10 hours of video playback. But what truly sets us apart is our graphics performance. We love graphics, and building processors with integrated graphics is one of our specialties. And so, second-gen Ryzen actually offers up to 10 Radeon Vega graphics cores and enables real gaming in an ultra-thin form factor. And we're proud to be able to deliver discrete-level graphics performance in a single chip for ultra-thins. But great graphics requires more than just high-performance hardware. One of the things I love about this community is I hear from you guys all the time, whether it's Twitter or Reddit or all that stuff. And gamers know that software is just as important. And we're passionate about ensuring that gamers have the latest and greatest drivers. So starting next month, we will make our most advanced discrete-level graphics drivers available with Ryzen Mobile. And those users can get that direct from AMD.com. Now, the chips are great, but all of this innovation really comes together in new systems from the world's top OEMs. And we are extremely honored to really have a record number of Ryzen-powered notebooks coming to the market this year. From Acer, Asus, Dell, HP, Huawei, Lenovo, and Samsung. Actually, if you walk the show floors, you can see many of these new designs on display here at CES. And you're going to see them available in retail later this quarter. So, really cool, and thank you for everything. Now, we have talked about high-performance PCs for creators and for consumers, but there's another important group for whom PCs are a tool of choice. Computers actually play a major role, especially for those focused on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. And frankly, this is an area that's really near and dear to my heart. So for these students, computer labs and high-performance PCs are now integral to how they learn. So let's take a look at the role computing plays in education today.
So we were founded in 1938 as a school for highly achieving students. We've always had a focus on STEM, on science, technology, engineering, and math.
We have courses in C++, game development, app development, quantum computing, and supercomputing. We have kids who specialize in machine learning, who do artificial intelligence. There's a very high likelihood that they will rise up to be leaders in trying to solve the problems.
And to be these future leaders, future engineers, to be innovators, they really have to be lifelong learners. I think that one of the biggest changes I've seen is how we use technology to enhance education.
We have amazing technology available to us, motion detectors, force meters, things that really in the high school level most people don't have access to. And because of that, the students are able to engage with the material directly and come up with things on their own.
The thing I like most about technology is that it lets you create things, it lets you do things, whether that's through research, development, scripts, algorithms, whatever you want.
So that motivation goes beyond their studies. It goes beyond the fact that they're motivated to do well or learn a lot. It's that they're motivated to apply their abilities to something bigger than themselves.
I've realized that if I could take my passion in engineering and my love for combining multifaceted approaches and solutions to problems, that maybe I could actually make tangible change in developing countries.
And I definitely think that it's something that we should be devoting a substantive amount of resources towards in the future, is continuing the cycle of innovation.
I don't know what I want to be, I just know that I want to use technology somehow to make a difference.
Every single day I'm learning new things about the people around me, and then in turn seeing where we connect and maybe how we can make the world a better place.
All right. I don't know about you guys, but I don't think I was that smart when I was in high school. I was actually at Bronx Science just last month, and it actually totally blew me away as to how much they were using PCs and actually even servers in the classroom. And so, you know, at AMD, we're really committed to making our products more broadly available in education. We already have deep partnerships with Microsoft and Apple on their education platforms. But this week at CES, we're announcing that the first AMD-powered Chromebooks. And when you look at Chromebooks, starting with the Acer Chromebook 315 and the HP Chromebook 14, leading global OEMs will release multiple AMD-powered Chromebooks this year. We've actually gotten really great reception. And I think the idea is that we want a broad ecosystem. And so it's our job to bring technology to the broadest possible ecosystem. So thank you very much for the support on Chrome. Okay, so let's turn our full attention now to immersive devices and the exciting world of gaming. AMD is the only company that delivers high-performance CPUs and GPUs for PCs, consoles, and cloud gaming. And if you take a look today, there are more than 400 million gamers in the world who play on Radeon graphics. Gaming is actually a large part of the recent growth of PCs, and if you look across the gaming market, we're seeing secular growth. So, you know, we expect annually 15% growth through 2021. And why is that? Why is gaming so popular? Gaming actually brings people closer together. It helps connect them with their friends and their family. Gamers also love technology, and they have extremely high expectations. And so they provide us with great feedback on our products. And that's why we love all types of gaming at AMD. So let's start our exploration of gaming with one of the best people in the industry on this subject and a great friend of AMD. Please welcome to the stage head of gaming at Microsoft, Phil Spencer.
Thanks.
How are you, Phil?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
Phil, thank you so much for being here. It's great to have you at CES.
On your first CES keynote, it's awesome to be here on stage.
It's truly fantastic. Now, I have to say, guys, Phil is a legend in the gaming industry. Is Phil a legend? He's a humble legend. But Phil, tell us a little bit about what's happening in gaming.
Yeah, you know, it's great to see the great growth in gaming over the last few years. Gaming has truly become a mainstream form of entertainment. You see games now that are talked about on the morning news. You go to schools. A lot of kids' first introduction to technology is through games, games like Minecraft, games like Roblox. It's just such a great on-ramp to our youth and for all of us to come together and entertain each other.
No, that's no question, no question at all. Now, Phil, you know, our teams have worked really hand-in-hand on Xbox for multiple years. Can you talk a little bit about our partnership and what we can create together?
Well, a moment I love. November 2017, we launched Xbox One X together. Xbox One X was the last console that we've launched together. That console put in the hands of creators the ability to build absolutely the best versions of their games. True 4K entertainment, and you see this. You see this with AAA games today. They're playing so well on that platform, and it's just awesome. The collaboration has been key. But even more in depth in the way our teams work together, one of the key features for us was backward compatibility. The fact that today's Xbox One console can play games from the 360 generation and even the original Xbox generation, which required work at the silicon level to make sure.
It was a lot of work, Phil.
It was.
Okay, just saying.
But not only does it play those games, it actually plays those games better than the original console. And to think about that, those games were created at a time they had no idea that an Xbox One X would be there. And the games are running fantastic, and that was due to the great partnership that we have.
Yeah, no, thank you. Look, we are really, really proud of our work together on Xbox. I think our teams are, you know, so motivated. And, you know, when we look at Microsoft in gaming, I mean, you've been in gaming for a long time, but it seems like recently gaming has become even more important for Microsoft. Is that true?
Yeah, you know, the Satya Nadella, Microsoft CEO, and I, we were talking a lot about what gaming could mean for Microsoft. You know, there are about 4 billion connected consumers on the planet today, and about 2 billion of those play video games. Just think about that, half the connected world playing video games. It's the scale of market that Microsoft should be a part of. And I said for a lot of today's youth, their first introduction to compute is through some form of video game that they're playing. Gaming's also going through a digital transformation that both of us are seeing in so many industries. The cloud is playing a more and more important role in today's for game developers today, and the local devices are enabling people to play all kinds of games across all kinds of devices, which is just a perfect area for Microsoft to be focused, and I get to keep my job, which is something that I love, so that's good.
Well, look, we love that vision. We love 2 billion gamers. Let's talk a little bit about the underlying technology and what do we have to do to really power that vision.
Yeah, when we look forward, say, over the next decade, and we say, what are you going to need to invest in to ensure that you're a leading game company? There are three components that are critically important as we see them. One, and first and foremost always, is the content. Gamers play games. People want to see great games. They want to play great games. They want to watch people play great games. We've invested at Microsoft in more first-party content, and the industry at large is creating more diverse and more interesting games than we ever have before. Content is critical. As you talked about before, gamers know how to reach us. Gamers are communal. They like to give feedback. They like to talk to each other. They like to play with each other on services like Xbox Live, to watch gameplay on services like Twitch and Mixer. Community is such an important part of what gaming is about and really differentiates it relative to other forms of entertainment in some pretty interesting ways. I'd say the third area that's becoming even more critical as we want to enable gamers to play games on any device is the cloud. Earlier this fall, we showed a video for Project X Cloud. We announced our initiative to bring gaming, AAA gaming, to any device, and we're using the silicon work that we've done together to ensure that the thousands of games that have already been built for the Xbox platform are enabled on that platform with no work from the developer. And that's really down to the work that our teams have done together to ensure that those cloud blades that we're putting in our Azure data centers today run all of the great Xbox games that people love to play.
Now, that's fantastic. Look, we love that. You know, as a hardware company, I mean, we really love the idea that you can bring all the content together, you know, across all of these different platforms. And frankly, it's, you know, it's a technical challenge for us, but it's one that makes a lot of sense to go after. So can we talk a little bit about what's next?
Yeah, you know, we're, as a company, we look at the opportunity in gaming. And one of the things I wanted to say is when we think about who our partners are, we think about great companies that do great work, but also in the right way. And you are somebody that I've respected a ton in this industry, and I've seen the way you've led AMD. And I think having a partner like AMD that works so collaboratively with us on our future technology, but also at a cultural level, I think fits so well. It's just awesome to have you as a partner.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. And as we look forward to future platforms that we're building and work that we're doing, the partnerships and the innovations that we've seen in the past that have led to what we've been able to do today, I think are going to be critically important to our future endeavors. So I'm really looking forward to showing those to people more in the future.
Fantastic. Well, Phil, thank you so much. We are honored to be your partner. We're honored to be Microsoft's partner. And we have a lot of exciting things going in the future, so we look forward to that as well. Thank you again, Phil.
Thank you, Lisa. Have a good show.
Thank you. Look, you know, I hope Phil's perspective on the future of gaming is as exciting for you as it is for us, because we really believe this. We really believe we can make this happen. And we can't make, we can't wait to make all of this a reality. But in the meantime, there's a lot for PC gamers to get excited about today. So last November, we launched what PC World called the new 1080p gaming champion, the Radeon RX 590. The 590 is a perfect card for PC gamers who play on 1080p monitors. And frankly, that's two-thirds of the market today. The 590 also is our latest graphics card that supports Radeon FreeSync technology. And FreeSync is an industry standard that syncs up the GPUs and the monitors so that gamers can experience a tear and stutter-free experience. And because it is an industry standard, you get all of this gameplay with no additional cost. Now, FreeSync is really, really popular and just gets bigger. It's the world's largest ecosystem for adaptive sync, and we have more than 550 gaming monitors and TVs that now run on FreeSync, and that's growing every single day. It's really an experience that you must see to fully appreciate. Another area that we're very proud of is our Radeon software. This is actually the fastest ramping part of our business in terms of really getting the software needed for all this capability. Over the past 4 years, we have delivered day zero driver support for over 100 AAA games at launch. And just last month, we released the Radeon Software Adrenaline 2019 edition. So you get performance improvements across some of the popular titles, but we've also added quite a few features in Radeon software. Things like one-touch GPU auto overclocking, in-game instant replay, the ability to stream from your to your phones and tablets, and even VR headsets. So all of those have come together in a great ecosystem. But as I said, we know exactly what's on gamers' minds. And there is a very passionate group of gamers and creators we've been getting something ready for as well. AMD loves gamers. AMD loves high performance. So for all of our Radeon fans, it's time to meet the next generation of high-performance gaming GPUs. really happy to show you for the very first time our new high-end GPU for gamers and creators, AMD Radeon 7. Radeon 7 is the second generation Vega graphics core. It is the world's first 7-nanometer gaming GPU. And when you look at what it delivers, we really deliver leadership performance in content creation, thank you, and compute workloads. And so when you power enthusiast level gaming, you need it in all kinds of ways. So where does all that performance come from? Radeon 7 has 60 compute units running at up to 1.8 gigahertz. Radeon 7 uses advanced 7-nanometer process technology. As I said, this is the world's first 7-nanometer gaming GPU. And what we get for that is 25% more performance at the same power. And lastly, Radeon 7 has massive memory. 16 gigabytes of high bandwidth memory with industry-leading terabyte per second of memory bandwidth. So if you think about all of that memory and all of that compute, you can imagine how good this GPU is for content creation. If you take a look at some of the most important benchmarks in creative workloads, we see up to 30% improvement in things like Blender and Adobe Premiere. You can imagine 30% does a lot. We see up to 62% more performance in GPU compute workloads based on OpenCL. And when you think about all of these performance games, they are really, really good for creators, and we love that. But we know that you guys want to know, how does Radeon 7 perform in gaming? We really built Radeon 7 for gamers, and these are the cream of the crop, the folks that want high frame rates when playing at the highest quality visual settings at max resolutions. And we have some really large improvements from first-generation Vega. What you see is across Vulkan, DX12, and some of the popular esports titles, you see significant improvements when running at 4K and max settings. And the thing about Radeon 7 is we also use some of our new Vega features, things like async compute, rapid pack math, shader intrinsics. These are all being used by game developers to create even better and more immersive gaming experiences. But that may be enough of me talking about the card. You may actually want to see Radeon 7 in action. So I think my friend Chris is here. Chris, let's show Radeon 7 running a really, really cool new title. It's the upcoming Devil May Cry 5 running at 4K. So this is the first time that Devil May Cry 5 is being shown, running on Radeon 7. And it's the latest version of the successful Devil May Cry action-adventure feature series from Capcom. AMD has actually worked very closely with the development team to optimize the game engine to create the photorealistic characters and some of the environments that you see here. And if you take a look at the performance, we have the frame rates up there. You can see the game is running super, super fast in 4K ultra settings, way above 60 frames per second. So there you see it. I want to give a really, really big thanks to our partners at Capcom for letting us show DMC5 before it launches. This title launches March 8th, and we're really excited to be working with Capcom on it. So thank you very much, Chris. We really believe at the high-end enthusiast market, you need great hardware. And gamers who want to run AAA titles in 4K at max settings will be really happy with Radeon 7 and how it performs compared to the competition. Radeon 7 has better performance in some of the latest Vulkan games, like Strange Brigade, and is very competitive at both DX11 and DX12 games. And I know for some of the press here in the audience, you guys are working, you guys are waiting to get Radeon 7. You will get them and be able to do some really cool reviews. Now, in addition to Capcom, we partner closely with many developers. And it's really that close partnership that allows us to take advantage of the features of our Radeon GPUs. So to discuss a bit more about our partnership with game developers, let me invite David Pohlfeld to the stage. He's head of Ubisoft's Massive Entertainment Studio. David? How are you, David?
Good, fantastic. What a huge crowd.
It's a great crowd, isn't it?
It looks fantastic.
Thank you, by the way. David joined us all the way from Sweden, so we really appreciate it. David, we are so proud of the partnership that we have with Ubisoft. We've done some great, great work together across Far Cry 3 and 5, The Division, Rainbow Six, and a few others. So can you tell us a little bit about why hardware partnerships are so important for you to deliver these incredible gaming experiences?
Of course, and thank you for having me here on stage. It's a real pleasure. My first time in Vegas, fantastic AMD event, so congratulations. And you know, I'm really excited to be part of announcing the Radeon 7 to gamers everywhere. And as you know, partnering with the best hardware developers in the world is very important to us, and specifically with AMD, because you guys have created what most gamers play on. And it's very important for us to ensure that our fans have the best experience. No, it's true.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you so much. And you know, our collaboration has enabled us to bring our creative vision to life by helping us develop new worlds, increase frame rates, and support higher fidelity visuals.
You know, David, The Division was actually the biggest game launch in Ubisoft history. And today we're working on something even much more ambitious with The Division 2. So how can you make something that was so great, you know, even better?
First of all, I have to say it's great to work with people who are as ambitious as we are. That's been a real treat. And we're incredibly proud to partner with AMD to deliver smooth and awe-inspiring visuals in 4K resolution, while letting players experience game-changing performance with The Division 2. So our partnership has allowed us to overcome several technical obstacles that we faced when we set out to create this huge, forward-looking and living world. But through AMD support, the technology features, the collaborative optimizations, we've been able to lower the barriers of entry and take advantage of everything that AMD has to offer. So supporting DX12 with The Division, I think, was just a testament to that collaboration and the beginning. But you know, while we're speaking, let's not forget to take a look at these wonderful shots from the game, because that's really cool.
Really, really beautiful. David, thank you. I think this is the first time anyone's seeing this, right? So, you know, rendering on all of those details at max settings and 4K resolution must require some pretty powerful GPUs.
Oh, completely. You're right. And, you know, that's why we wanted to show everyone here The Division 2 running at 4K settings on the Radeon 7.
He's on me!
Is that beautiful or what?
Woo! Thank you. I guess, welcome to Washington, I guess. So, and I just want to take this opportunity to thank you for building what we need based on our feedback that we've been having very, very tight dialogue when we were working on this. And it's not just with the hardware, it's also with the open source tools, GPU open, and I think it's one of many great examples of AMD listening to all of us. And it clearly shows, I think, in the world we built with The Division 2.
That is absolutely, absolutely gorgeous. Now, if you look at the collaboration between you know, our engineers and your Snowdrop engine development team, it is incredibly good. So what can we expect to appear in The Division 2 as a result of all that work?
Well, you know, the collaboration will translate into better performance and more realistic graphics for gamers. So at launch, The Division 2 will support the full set of advanced Radeon technology features.
Thank you, by the way, that's fantastic.
No problem. And DX12 with async compute is especially important for us because we want to open up this experience to players as possible.
That's fantastic. Look, we love the fact that you're using our tech. I mean, it's really great. It's why we build it, frankly.
Well, we love it too, you know, so it's we're just having fun.
Look, as exciting as it is to work on graphics together, you know, CPUs are also really, really important. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience with Ryzen?
I'd be happy to, because the Ryzen is really a beautiful piece of hardware. And, you know, the cores and the threads are allowing us to bring better performance and tighter gameplay to so many people. And at the end of the day, games are created on PCs. Yes. So it's an incredibly important platform to us. And we're super committed, and we wanted to show you that we're here to make the best experience possible on PC with AMD, but for everyone.
I think you have made a lot of PC gamers really happy today. So, David, thank you for this close partnership. Thank you for everything that you've done. Thank you for letting us look at Division 2 on Radeon 7. We can't wait for the game to come out and for gamers to experience.
I can't wait for it to come out either. But thanks for having me, and good luck with everything.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. So the Division 2 actually launches on March 15th, but for any of you here at CES who can't wait that long, please stop by Club AMD for your exclusive opportunity to play the game on Radeon 7. And I also have a couple of other things to say. We will be announcing that for a limited time, we will bundle Division 2 with Radeon 7 and select Ryzen 7 and Ryzen 5 second generation processors. And all of that is really to show you the power of our hardware, great title. And for all of you who are here in the room today, as you walk out, you're going to get your free copy of Division 2 as well. So just a little thank you. Okay, so look, we talked earlier about how gaming is increasingly social. And esports has become one of the fastest growing spectator sports in recent years. And the popularity is really only increasing. 6.6 billion hours were spent watching esports in 2018. 6.6 billion. That's mind-boggling. And if you look at the number of esports viewers, that are expected, we expect that to be almost 600 million by 2021. And from our own experience, I can tell you the top five games played on high-end AMD GPUs are all esports titles. One of the leading teams fueling this popularity is Fnatic. And for those of you who maybe aren't familiar with Fnatic or haven't seen an event, let's take a quick look at what it's all about. More about esports, I'd like to welcome Fnatic co-founder Sam Matthews to the stage. Hi. Hi, Sam. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
It's fantastic to have you here at CES. Tell us a little bit about what esports is all about.
Definitely. You know, it's amazing to be here. I'm so excited to talk about esports, and it really is the new world sport. You know, it's got a significant accessibility, it's completely global in nature, and massively scaling viewership, as you saw there. But what makes it so interesting is really how very engaging it is. It's captivating millions across the world. It's become almost as widespread as many traditional sports, and it's really here to stay. You know, Fnatic was created way back in 2004, and we've been, this year alone, it's 75 international tournaments across 10 different titles. Major games like League of Legends, Dota 2, Fortnite, CSGO, Rainbow Six, and many more. But in 2018, it was our most successful year yet.
Fantastic.
We placed first at a number of major CSGO tournaments and went all the way in probably the biggest esports tournament of all time, the League of Legends World Championships, which was watched by over 100 million people.
Well, that's fantastic, Sam. I mean, we're really proud of our collaboration and what we've done together. So, you know, many folks may be surprised to learn just, you know, how big this is. And, you know, we've now partnered for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, from your perspective, you know, why are high-performance CPUs and GPUs so important?
Definitely. I mean, esports teams, they really do require the best hardware to get them to victory. Our partnership with AMD started actually in 2016. We started with our League of Legends team, and the following year it went to all of our teams. But now, all of our players and teams compete exclusively on AMD Ryzen and Radeon RX graphics.
Thank you, by the way.
Ryzen really allows us to play and stream seamlessly with excellent quality, whilst Radeon is really about the ultra-high frame rates, even at the maximum settings. Technology like FreeSync is enabling that super smooth gameplay at the very highest levels. And you know what? Our teams have done extremely well in the past year, and we couldn't have done that without your support.
No, that's really fantastic, Sam. Look, we're really proud of what you guys are doing. One thing, I think most people don't normally think of esports as needing high-end GPUs. Mm-hmm. So why are high-performance GPUs like Radeon 7 so important for esports?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, more so than any other sport, esports is reliant on its hardware. You know, with the right hardware, our players have a noticeable advantage over the competition and really helps to improve their performance. Our players and teams' livelihood can sometimes literally depend on the performance of their PC and their graphics card. That's why all of our players are powered by the best AMD PCs to both qualify and train for major tournaments. A great example of this, our Dota 2 team, currently the top team in Southeast Asia, relies on this performance to qualify for the International, which is the biggest Dota tournament. With $25 million on prize money on the line, you can understand how the performance has a massive financial implication.
This is pretty big business you got here.
Yeah. The same goes for all the other teams, you know, whether it's Counter-Strike, League of Legends, or Rainbow Six.
No, that's fantastic. I mean, look, that's what we build for, frankly.
Yep.
So, you know, Sam, you know, we have a lot of folks here in the room, and I'm sure a lot on the live stream that are gamers, and you know, they want to play like the pros at home. So,
yep.
Can you help us understand what the ideal setup is, you know, for esports teams?
Definitely. I mean, players generally they play on 1080p, and they really want to maximize FPS. That's number one. Monitors should be at least 144 hertz, but most teams are making their way to 240 hertz if they're not there already. And GPUs like Radeon 7 really enable that to run smoothly. Low latency is also critical. Sometimes the difference can be between a win or a loss. And technologies like FreeSync, again, help players to address this. Streaming is increasingly an important part of what we do.
It's really amazing,
yeah.
By the way. So.
And it's you know, the PCs need to be powerful enough because it drives so much engagement and income for our audience. Ryzen and Radeon are ideal for streaming and high quality. And as you can imagine, Fnatic's ability to attract new talent really depends on our reputation, performance, and which is directly impacted by the hardware we use.
Yep, no, that makes perfect sense. Look, congratulations on everything that you guys have done in 2018. I know you're really excited about 2019.
Yep.
And we are really pleased to announce today that we're going to upgrade all of your teams to Radeon 7 in 2019.
So. Amazing. I'm sure my team is going to be super thrilled. That's fantastic. Thank you so much for having me. Honestly, this year has been an amazing year for us, and we look forward to continuing the support of AMD.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Sam.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Right, so hopefully by now you realize that Radeon 7 is the most powerful gaming GPU we have ever built, and really the most powerful consumer GPU available for content creation. It's really the best of both worlds. And I'm happy to announce today some more specifics on Radeon 7. Radeon 7 will go on sale on February 7th for $699 from leading e-tailers, system integrators, direct on AMD.com, and an Alienware Area 51 desktop. So really, really excited. And we're also saying for a limited time, Radeon 7 will become bundled with Resident Evil 2, DMC5 that you saw, and The Division 2. So what do you think of that? So look, we are super excited about Radeon 7, and I hope you guys are as well. But I'd also like to wrap up our gaming discussion with one more partner story, just to show you the depth of what we do. If you look today, we stream music, we stream applications, and we stream video. So the question is, why not AAA games? This morning, I'm pleased to announce for the first time that AMD has been working closely with one of the leaders in cloud computing. AMD, together with Google, have been working to bring game streaming to life with the Project Stream program launched last October. Google chose to test Project Stream with one of the most demanding games out there, Assassin's Creed Odyssey from Ubisoft. And if you take a look, all you need is a Wi-Fi connection and a Chrome browser to stream the game from Google's AMD-powered cloud servers in high-fidelity 1080p at 60 frames per second. So just take a look at some of the capability. Is that beautiful or what? reception has been really great, and it's really clear to see why. Pushing that many pixels through a small pipe is incredibly difficult. It requires deep engagement across hardware and server providers, as well as game developers. And because even if you have just 1 second of buffering, this thing would be unplayable. We worked very closely with Google to optimize this experience with our cloud-based virtualized GPUs. And it's really so that gamers could get that same experience they have come to expect on their PC delivered in their browser. That's why we are so proud that Google has selected high-performance AMD Radeon Pro GPUs based on our Vega architecture to power Project Stream. So we like to say that Radeon graphics are everywhere, and we are thrilled that Google is now part of that portfolio with Project Stream. And to wrap up the gaming section, let me say again, AMD loves gaming, and AMD loves gamers. We have one aspiration. We want to be the technology of choice for gamers and developers across the entire ecosystem, PCs, consoles, and cloud. And I'm extremely excited to start the year launching the first 7-nanometer GPU with Radeon 7. But we have a lot more coming this year, so both on next-generation CPUs and GPUs, and I look forward to sharing more of that progress as the year progresses. So, with that, now let me turn to the world of high-performance computing. If you take a look over the coming years, we have an incredible opportunity to solve some of the biggest challenges we face by applying more powerful computing and artificial intelligence to key problems. Things like climate change, things like energy solutions, medical research, and much, much more. In 2017, we took a big step forward to address this market with the introduction of our AMD EPYC server processor. If you take a look at EPYC, what it does is it combines more cores, more memory, and more I/O to offer leadership performance at every price point. And it has been a tremendous, tremendous first year for EPYC. There are more than 50 EPYC platforms that are now shipping from the leading server providers. And AMD is also winning in the biggest cloud environments. Microsoft Azure offers their highest performance big data in HPC instances on EPYC. Amazon offers EPYC on their most powerful cloud instances. And if you use AWS, you can save 10% or more by simply migrating your instance to EPYC. And the process takes about 4 minutes to do. Really, really simple. And then if you take a look at the floating point performance and the memory bandwidth of EPYC, this is really the ideal platform for supercomputing. And that's why EPYC is winning in a lot of places, from space exploration to F1 racing to cutting-edge scientific research. To give you a little bit of an idea of why EPYC is so important, let's hear from the researchers at Oregon State University.
We do a very extensive amount of work that ranges from genomics research, where we actually assemble genomes and annotate genomes, all the way to where we're doing deep learning and machine learning and run simulations of different things like modeling species diversity in forests. The Center for Genome Research constantly reevaluates its HPC needs. We have individual departments pushing through between 500,000 to 1 million jobs a year. So the hardware has to be able to embrace that. We know that the hardware has to be able to handle that.
The major workload that the EPYC platform is enabling us to do new research is basically just handling simultaneous multiprocessing jobs. It's the thread count that really matters.
The bacteria I study have no cure, so detecting them quickly and carefully is really important for preventing disease, as they cause millions of dollars in damage every year in agricultural systems. What we are able to do is to sequence the genomes of hundreds of thousands of these bacteria, investigate their gene content and compare it to bacteria that don't cause disease, On our previous systems we had, this type of analysis would take 10 days to run, but with the EPYC server, we were able to complete them in 2 days.
The evolution of AMD seems to be on task with how research computing moves forward, and we plan to continue our relationship with them because they help us reinvent how we're doing our science.
High-performance computing is the most important scientific tool today. So continuing that kind of advancement, what that allows us to do is really look at how molecular processes happen at an accuracy that we've never dreamed of before.
The future of science is definitely on the computational side. I'm really excited to see how this moves forward in the future, where we have such tremendous computing power, how we can apply this to problems in agriculture, in medicine, and I see this as the future of science and where things are headed.
We get excited about answers. In the end, to us, the technology is how we get to our answers, and that's what excites us. Seeing the science actually get somewhere and actually be able to change the world in a positive way is how we're using this technology, and that's what keeps the scientists going.
So those are pretty significant gains you're seeing in performance from OSU with EPYC. But it's clear they can use much, much more computing. So in 2019, that's exactly what we're going to do with the next generation EPYC processor. Second gen EPYC is powered by our new Zen 2 processor core and built using the world's most advanced 7-nanometer manufacturing technology. And I will go so far as to say that we believe it is the best server processor the world has ever seen. We are seeing incredible performance gains compared to the current generation EPYC. Things like 4 times the floating point performance, double the compute performance per socket, and up to 64 cores and 128 threads per processor. And we use the same socket and the same platform as the current generation, which actually makes upgrading really easy. So all of these inflection points really create server performance in 2019 beyond what we've seen before. So if you just take a look at the annual trend line, second generation EPYC sits way above the line. It's a big leap in server performance from the past few years. And to really see how this performance translates into real-world improvements, let's take a look at a demo. We're going to show you, this is a popular scientific application called NAMD. NAMD is a high-performance simulator used by scientific researchers to study highly complex molecular systems. And one of the reasons NAMD is so popular and powerful is that it's very, very scalable. So the idea is that you can increase the performance by just increasing the number of cores that you use, up to 500,000 cores. So to demonstrate the power of our next generation EPYC, I'm going to show you a demo. And what the demo is it's a single early version of EPYC processor compared to 2 of our competitors' highest-end Xeon Platinum 8180 processors. And it really just shows you the difference. So let's take a look at the demo. So what you're seeing on the screen is an incredibly complex simulation, and it's really the atomic movement and combination of a common HDL protein component. And if you take a look at the bottom, what you see there is the important metric. It's actually the number of nanoseconds per day that you can run. And what you see is that you have a single EPYC processor running against 2 Intel processors, and the EPYC processor is running faster. It's running about 15% faster. And so if you take a look at all of that together, it's what makes EPYC so special. A single EPYC processor against 2 of our competitors' best, and what you see is an increase in performance. And so with that, you can see that scientific researchers can really do a heck of a lot more. And that's what we're trying to do, right? We're trying to advance the power of computing going forward. So I know a lot of people are wondering what actually a dual socket EPYC will look like, and we're going to talk about that very soon. So I'm very happy to announce today that the second generation AMD EPYC processor is absolutely on track, and we will start shipping in the middle of 2019. Okay, so as exciting as EPYC is, and you know, we're very, very excited about EPYC, I've got one more big thing for you today. Are you guys excited about Ryzen?
Yeah!
I love you guys, by the way. I love you guys. Look, our mission with Ryzen has always been clear, okay? Our job is to push the boundaries of what can be done by a desktop processor. The third-gen Ryzen processor is the next big thing in that mission. Third-gen Ryzen is also powered by the Zen 2 core. Also has 7-nanometer technology. And as a desktop processor, it will absolutely set the bar on performance, technology, and power efficiency. And to show you a little bit, I'm going to give you today the first ever public preview. of what next-gen Ryzen can do. So let's take a look. Let's begin with PC gaming. My friend James. Are you ready? Okay, James, let's show the audience what we got here. So what you're seeing is an early version of our third-gen Ryzen desktop processor. By the way, it's also running with Radeon 7 GPU. It's running the performance-intensive Forza 4 gaming from Microsoft Studios. And we like this game because it really stresses the computing power. And as you can see, we have the frame rates up there. The game is running consistently at more than 100 frames per second at 1080p with maximum settings. This system that James is running is the most advanced PC gaming hardware in the world, together in one system. Third gen Ryzen, Radeon 7. What do you think? Thank you very much, James. Good job. You didn't crash. Thank you. He was worried, by the way. I was worried, too. But look, I know you guys well. I know the enthusiast community. And you're asking yourself, how does Ryzen really perform compared to the competition? So let's take one more look, just one more look. Let me make sure I have my guys. Okay, you guys are there. Sit tight. Louis and Amit are from our engineering team, and they've been with Ryzen all along. What we're going to show you today is now third-gen Ryzen with a head-to-head comparison against the top-of-the-line Core i9-9900K running the industry standard Cinebench benchmark. So note, let me tell you what we're running. We're running 8-core, 16-thread Ryzen. Not final frequency, early sample, and we're running stock frequencies of the Intel part. So, Louis and Amit, are you ready? Okay, let's start the demo, please. So, Cinebench is going to run for a little while. What you're also seeing, just so you know, are the powers. These are the system powers that you see from each. And as I said, the image on the left is the competing processor. The image on the right is Ryzen. And what you can see, let's take a look at the Cinebench scores. Ryzen looks like 2057. Our competitor is running at 2040. So that sounds like a win. Does it sound like a win? The other thing that's really important is the system power. So you can see that the system power of third-gen Ryzen is running actually about 30% lower than of the competing system. So now you really see the power of 7-nanometer technology and what being aggressive with technology does. So thank you, Louis and Amit. Great job. As you can tell, I really love building chips, okay? I really love building chips. And some of you may actually wonder, what third generation Ryzen actually looks like. So, take a look. For the first time, we will show you how Ryzen looks under the hood. And you can see, it's different. It's different from what you normally expect. It's using our industry-leading chiplet design. So the smaller die is our 7 nanometer Zen 2 processor die with 8 cores and 16 threads. The larger of the dies is actually our I/O die. This I/O die is specifically designed for the PC market and for desktops, and it feeds the data between the Zen 2 engine and the rest of the system. And so one of the things that's pretty important is to take advantage of some of the faster graphics cards and devices that are coming to market later this year. Next-gen Ryzen will also be the world's first PC platform to support the ultra-fast PCI Express Gen 4 standard. What do you think? I guess I'll keep the chip. So, look. By now, you're starting to understand why we get so excited about technology. Being first to 7, really pushing the envelope on system architecture, third-gen Ryzen is aimed at leadership, true leadership. Performance, features, power. And one of the things that we feel really passionately about is the extension of the infrastructure. So third-gen Ryzen will run on the same AM4 desktop infrastructure. So it's really simple. For all of you who are on Ryzen today, really simple upgrade drop-in for users. So I know you guys want to know a lot more about third-gen Ryzen. We have a lot going on, and I'm really happy to tell you that we look forward to sharing that information as we get closer to the product launch. And we will be launching in the middle of 2019. All right, so look, today I've shown you a lot. I've shown you CPUs, I've shown you GPUs, I've shown you what's required to really get a step function in computing performance and really put us on a new trajectory moving forward. And I want to tell you, on behalf of all of the 10,000 AMDers, we are absolutely determined to drive high-performance computing innovation at the bleeding edge. This is our job one. Whether you're talking about heterogeneous system design, or you're talking about future cores and twos and threes and fours and five, Navi, all of these, we're putting all of these architectures together, and we're putting them together in new ways. But as much technology as we've shown, there really is a lot more to come. So let me just finish up on a little bit more of a personal note. I love semiconductors. I love semiconductors and what we can do for the world. Over my career, I've really been focused on how can we push the limits? How can we push the limits to solve really tough problems, whether they're technology problems or business problems? You know, my view of the world is a problem is actually an opportunity. And so although we have some challenges, the opportunities that we face are much greater. And I know what's really important to us is coming together collectively as an industry, working across boundaries with all the partners that we have, all the partners we have on stage, all the OEMs. We can turn the impossible to the possible. And at AMD, we're on that journey. We're on that journey to build a future where high-performance computing is at the foundation of what enables the smartest and the brightest minds to solve the world's toughest and most interesting challenges. So I'd like to believe when we look back on today, when we look back on 2019, we're going to see that this is an inflection point in that journey. It's going to be an incredibly exciting 2019. Thank you for all your support, and thank you for your time today.